don't know. Maybe y'all didn't hear me. I hope not. I'm glad you're here tonight. I'm thankful that you're here tonight. We're going to read quite a few verses, but we're only going to really cover one verse tonight. And a reprieve. I know I need to, this needs to be the night that I preach like every verse, right? Just finish up Galatians and, you know. Oh, my goodness. Well, we're going to jump into our study tonight. Is there anybody that did not get a copy of the notes tonight? Anyone who did not get a copy? Oh, my goodness. I got one, Brother Brian, if you find them while you're out there. Thank you, sir. I know you're doing something else, so that's okay. There's two. I got two. I got one there, my daughter, and then Brother Dwight over here. My other daughter. My littlest daughter wants to scribble on one. She wants. Did you see that face? All right, we'll get it there. Brother Steve, I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. I meant to find you while we were after you're done counting. When you're done counting, if you'll go down to the business office, we ran the reports last night. They're sitting down there, the one report. We just need to bring it up here and make copies of it. Can you? You don't know how to make copies. I don't know how to make copies. Miss Marianne, when he brings it up, will you make copies of it for me? Okay. All right. I just wanted to get that out because I want you to look at it, and I want you to praise the Lord through it. And I'm just blessed at how God worked. And I want to thank you for your faithfulness in giving and your faithfulness in your attendance tonight. Galatians chapter 5, we're going to begin in verse 16. And like I said, we're going to read quite a few verses, but we're really going to focus on verse 16 tonight. Because I want you to get this. I want you to grasp this. I think this will improve our lives, improve our walk, if we'll do this. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variances, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are in Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let's also walk in the Spirit." We'll stop there for the reading tonight, because we're going to study in depth these verses here. But tonight I want us to specifically stop and look at this verse in verse 16. "This I say then, walk in the Spirit." I entitled this "Walk, Don't Run." How many times have you heard that as a little kid? My littlest kid loves to run everywhere she goes. And I say, "Walk, don't run," especially in the house. So tonight, let's walk. Let's walk in the Spirit. Father, I need you tonight. I pray that you'd help us as we go through these verses that you've laid out for me tonight. I pray that we would glean from your word, that we would leave changed because of it, and apply it to our hearts and lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Here, as we break down just verse 16, Brother Michael's going to run our screens for us tonight. So if anything goes wrong, everybody just yell, "Michael!" He just shrunk and hid. Pop yourself back up. Get back up there where I can see your face. There we go. Yeah, I want to be able to see your face. Here we go. All right, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, "This I say, then walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." Here, breaking it down, "This I say then." The verb "say" here is in a present active indicative. Now, yeah, those are big words, and we're talking about the declension or the ending of the Greek word and what it means, which means to continue to say or keep saying. So Paul is obviously reiterating something to them that he has taught, that he's going to continue teaching, and that he wants them to recognize and pay attention to. He says, walk in the Spirit. This is the present active writing of this phrase, which means to continue to walk in the Spirit. Present going forward. Walk in the Spirit. And he wants them to walk, continue walking in the Spirit. And he says, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. This is written in a subjunctive mood. Now that subjunctive mood, which means it is dependent upon something else. This phrase here, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, is dependent on something else. Well, what's it dependent on? Walking in the Spirit. He says, so if, it's kind of like, remember back an if-then statement? If this is true, then this is true. That's what the subjunctive mood means. So here he says, if you walk in the Spirit, then you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, this verse is a powerful verse that each of us must deal with on a daily basis. A daily basis. This is something we need to stop and account for every day that God gives us breath. Every day that we breathe, we need to be paying attention and focusing and recognizing this verse. It's key. Now, notice this verse says, now this is where we get into trouble. It says, walk in the Spirit. It does not say, walk with the Spirit. It says, walk in the Spirit, not walk with the Spirit. This is key here. This is key. Why? When we think of walking with someone, we can choose to not do so. If I'm walking with somebody and they're just with me, okay, I can choose a different road. I can choose a different path. The other day, we were coming down 124 and there was somebody that wasn't quite driving very carefully. They were all over the road. So I chose to go a different way. I cut over on Henry Clower Boulevard and I was just going to come around. I just didn't want to be close to the other car. I don't know whether they were texting, whether they were, you know, screaming at somebody on the phone. You never know these days. And I tell you what, some of those people that get in those heated conversations on the phone, they're kind of fun to watch. I mean, they're talking with their hands and it looks like they're talking to somebody in the car when there's not nobody else in the car, you know. Or you get these people that are singers. And they just know they should be, you know, those professional singers. All right? And you see them and they are into the song. And I mean, in it so much that they're doing motions and they're dancing with it as they sing. I mean, just all sorts of things. The other day, I drove up behind this car, and this car was, I mean, the radio was so loud, I could hear the music, and you saw everybody going like this in the car, and before long, everybody got to doing it at the exact same time, doing the same move, and the car started doing this. I was like, wow. So I don't know what was going on with the driver of this other car, but I said, look, I just choose to take a different route. See, I was driving alongside that car, so we were with each other. I chose not to. Here the Bible says, walk in the Spirit. It doesn't say walk with the Spirit. When we think of walking with someone, we can choose to not do so. We spend too many days thinking that we can walk how we want to since we are walking with the Spirit. But I want you to understand the Spirit dwells within us. We just need to make sure that we walk in Him, placing ourselves back in Him. Because see, I started looking at that, the simple word in, I-N. It's a preposition. It's used as a preposition. It's also used as an adverb. And it's used in some other ways that really don't, using this Greek term here, it doesn't represent it, right? So the ways it could is a preposition as well as an adverb. But here, the preposition in, expressing the situation of something that is or appears to be enclosed or surrounded by something else. Surrounded by something else. As an adverb, it's expressing movement with the result that someone or something becomes enclosed or surrounded by something else. Expressing the situation of being enclosed or surrounded by something. Literally, being in something is to be completely enclosed by it. Anybody agree with that statement tonight? So when we're talking about walking in the Spirit, means that as we go, once again, this is a verse that we need to daily take account for. This means we must be walking in the Spirit, completely enclosed within the Spirit. I tried to find one today. You know those big inflatable balls that you see people that they put them on and they're like this big and they run and play sports and stuff in them nowadays and they bang into each other and things. I tried to find one today for this illustration, but I couldn't find one. But they get in these balls and they go running up and down the field playing soccer or whatever. I think it's more to run over each other than it is to play the game of soccer. But they're big inflatable and it's about this big and they're in it. And as they're running around and they bump into things and they bounce off other teammates and other things, there's this craziness that goes on. But they're safe and secure inside the bubble. And so many times, listen, I want you to understand, God desires for us to be in the Spirit, dwelling within Him, allowing ourselves, submitting ourselves back to Him. And then He begins laying it out, and like I said here, now I want you to understand, I was reading this and studying literally for next week, but here in Galatians chapter 5, verses 17 through 25, I want you to understand, he writes it to Galatia, the church in Galatia. He writes it to the church of Colossians. And he writes it to the church at Rome. Well, what do you know? All of them were having the same issue. Now remember, he's battling. It goes back to this, to the understanding of why he's writing this. Law, works versus flesh. Right? Works versus flesh. And here he's trying to bring them back because, once again, he has this mind. They have this mindset that it's all about the works I do. And he begins to lay it out. Well, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. He's making an argument that it has to be the Spirit. We are quickened by the Spirit, not by the law. He says, because here's the problem: the flesh. The works of the flesh, the works of the law, lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary one to another. He says, look, there's a battle here, and they're contrary. So that ye cannot do the things that ye would. Your flesh is going to compete, and it's going to win so that you can't do the things that you would ought to do. As Paul says, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things that I don't want to do, those I do. He says in verse 18, but if ye be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now, here he is going to begin listing the works of the flesh. He's going to lay it out for them. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. The word manifest, brought forth, shown forth. Okay? Here are the works of the law. And this is how they're manifest. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. Hey, interpreters, y'all can be studying up for this. You know this is next week, right? So heads up. But anyways, and we're going to break down each of those works and discuss them, and because the Bible gets pretty clear in describing this. He says this is where it becomes evident. Envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I've also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now he's talking about the fact that those who are trying to secure their salvation through the works of the law, they're doing works, but I want you to understand, their flesh is doing these things as well. These things he's laying out, he goes, yeah, they're trying by the works of the law. They're trying to, remember, keep the law of Abraham. Okay, but remember, if you offend, if you break one, you've broken them all. And he's trying to help them understand and recognize this. He's trying to help them realize this. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 7, in the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. Now we're going to get back to that verse, because that's a very interesting verse there. That ye walked in them, or ye lived in them. But here is the change. Now the change that should now characterize those believers. Verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. See, he understands. He's now placing spiritual rebirth, being born again of the Spirit. He's showing forth and helping them to recognize those things, those works of the flesh, those fleshly things are now crucified with Christ. Verse 25, if we live in the Spirit, salvation, let us also walk in the Spirit. Now let me just, these are some side note things, some things that I picked up on in the different verses as well as read. It says this, walking in the Spirit must begin by living in the Spirit. Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Walking in the Spirit must begin by living in the Spirit. Literally being walking in newness of the life. Miss Marianne, just never mind. I forgot. I think I was supposed to print it. That would be my fault. Yep, me. Yep. Sorry. She sent me a message. What report? Yeah, well. It's in my Dropbox. Does that help you any? Nope. All right, so walking in the Spirit. Sorry, you guys. My fault. I wasted all your time. Walking in the Spirit must begin by living in the Spirit, and that is, we should walk in newness of life, salvation. To walk in the Spirit is to mortify the deeds of the body. Romans chapter 8, 12, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. Verse 13, for if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die, but if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. And we'll talk about that mortify here in a few more minutes. To walk in the Spirit is to have help with infirmities. Romans chapter 8, verse 28, likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. To walk in the Spirit is to have help with our infirmities. I'm thankful for the help we have with our infirmities. Those things that we deal with, the fact that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, allows us, gives us a prayer partner, a prayer warrior, someone to pray with us. Now, to walk in the Spirit is to follow Him unreservedly. Unreservedly. 1 Thessalonians 5:19, quench not the Spirit. Can I tell you, there's so many times that we quench the Spirit of God by the way we walk, by the way we act, by the things we do, by the places we go. And that's sad. But I want you to understand, we must recognize and understand what quenches the Holy Spirit, what allows Him to work in our hearts and lives, what keeps us from serving Him, what keeps us from Him having full control in our lives. Now, Colossians, I told you, and he wrote to Colossae, he wrote to Rome, he wrote to Galatia. He said this, he said, Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, he says, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. That's the word mortify. Once again, it's more of an obsolete word that we don't use these days. But it means to destroy the strength, vitality, or functioning of. To destroy the strength, vitality, and functioning of. It also means to subdue or deaden. Deaden. As the body or bodily appetites, especially by abstinence or self-inflicted pain or discomfort, to deaden it. But he says in Colossians, he says, mortify your members. Verse 6 of Colossians chapter 3, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Talking about those things were to mortify, kill off. Verse 7, in the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. But now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Paul writes to Colossians, and in essence, he's talking about the same thing. He's trying to explain to them how by the works of the law, only holding to the works of the law, you will not attain heaven. You will not reach heaven. Because there's, and like I said, when we get into these words, I've said this before and I'll remind you, and then I'll remind you again next week. The Greek language was such a picturesque language. One word really meant several. I mean, literally, instead of just telling our English language, it pales in comparison. We may say, we may use a word, and it means one thing. But in Greek, it describes a picture, a full picture, not just one thing. So as we read back through these works of the flesh and these works of the law, these things that would keep them from attaining heaven, he's laying it out to them. Look, the works of the law won't work. But those of us that are born by the Spirit and live in the Spirit, in the hope of the Spirit, the faith in the Spirit, he says, these can mortify the flesh, can crucify those things. So let's just draw some application from to walk in the Spirit tonight. To walk in the Spirit tonight. Number one, you're going into battle. Walking in the Spirit is going to be a battle. Romans chapter 7, verse 23, Paul is talking to the Romans. He says, look, there is a war going on. Paul says, there is a war. Romans chapter 7, verse 23, he says, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. He doesn't say that this is a little skirmish. He doesn't say that this is a little confrontation. He says it's warring against me. And he's talking about his own flesh. His own sin nature was warring against him. And as it was warring against him, listen, we've got to recognize. He wants them to recognize. And each one of us have to recognize, listen, there is a battle that we face every single day. And all it takes is you letting down one day. Understand that. One time. One day, let down. And it could destroy your life. It says there's a battle. See, once again, if I come to you and say, oh, tomorrow's going to be sunny. Snowmageddon 2017 is coming. Sorry, I had to stop my illustration because, you know, last weekend was hilarious. We're going to get 5 to 6 inches. And everybody was prepared, weren't they? I mean, there was no bread, milk. You couldn't find it. Nowhere near. Well, yeah, it was good. We all got prepared. It was bad when we woke up Saturday morning and there was nothing on the ground. My kids were so disappointed. I was so proud of a couple of my kids, though. They said, we're not going to let this get us down. They took cookie sheets out and they slid down the back frozen dirt. They did pretty good. I was quite surprised. The frozen dirt was pretty slick. But when we expected something and it didn't happen, we were still prepared. We weren't, you know, yeah, we were disappointed, but it wasn't like if they didn't tell us and it did come, right? See, when somebody forewarns you about something, you can be prepared, mentally ready. I mean, I brought in a bunch of wood for the fireplace. I had it stacked up along the wall beside the fireplace. I mean, we were ready to be stuck inside for days. And I was kind of excited about it. But if they hadn't warned us and it had come, then we would have been overwhelmed. And people would have been panicky. And then there would have been craziness going on all over the place. I say all that to say this. Here, Paul says, I see another somebody else warring against me within me. If I forewarn you about a battle, about a war, about something extreme, you can be prepared for it. Paul here is trying to warn the church of Rome. Look, there's a war going on. I mean, this is all-out attack inside of me. I want you to understand, every day God gives you, there's a war going on. And guess what? You have to determine whether you're going to be ready to fight the battle or you're just going to let it happen to you. Because if you say, no, I'm just going to choose to do nothing, it's going to happen to you. And you'll be one of those people that wake up one day and go, I never knew it would take me this far. But I want you to understand, you're going into battle. You're going into war. You are going in and there is a fight going on. Look, there's a fight for physical sins. There's a fight for mental sins. There's a fight for your emotions. There's a fight for your reactions. There's a fight for everything about you. There's a battle. You need to be prepared for it. But tonight I want you to, we're talking about walking in the Spirit, okay? There's a battle that's going to go on for you. If you decide tonight, Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. Look, there's going to be a greater battle going on. And you need to fight. You need to be ready. But I need you to understand your battle tonight. Number two tonight, understand my battle. Understand my battle. Once again, you know you're going into battle. But let's understand who you're going to fight. So many times, missionaries, preachers, and the like, we all want to blame it on Satan, don't we? But can I tell you tonight, your battle is you. It's me. It's me. Your battle is you. The battle is your flesh. The battle is what's going on, your lust of the flesh, your pride of life. Those things is what you're going to battle the most. See, Satan's not omnipresent. He's not omnipotent. I do believe that he's got more power than we give him because he is a fallen angel. But I want you to understand, if he's tempting you, he can't be tempting me. And if he's tempting me, he can't be tempting you. That's a part of omnipresence and omnipotence that Satan doesn't control. But tonight, I want you to understand. Did y'all see that bug that flew up here? I saw everybody's eyes go like this. Yes, there was a stink bug that just flew up here, okay? All right. Is that settled? It's way over here, Miss Jennifer. Is there another one over there? Uh-oh. Brother Brian, be on the ready. All right. If you see some commotion over here and Brian starts screaming like a little girl running out, then no. Just teasing. Just teasing. But I want you to understand, okay, it's you. You need to be prepared and you need to recognize that the person you're going to have to battle, that you're going to have to fight, is yourself. But can I give you this encouragement? That was kind of discouraging. Let me give you this encouragement. If we are in Christ, we're not alone. To walk in the Spirit, to decide, Lord, tonight I want to walk in the Spirit. I want to be enclosed within your Spirit. I want to let your Spirit live and me just being the body, the container that carries it around. Then I want you to understand, you're not alone. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11, he says, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. See, we have the power of the Holy Spirit. Look, don't belittle the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is part of God. He is God. Therefore, we have God living in us. So, but understanding my battle, I need to recognize who I was. Colossians 3, 7, in the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. Remember how we were talking about walking in the Spirit? Here in verse 7 of Colossians, he's talking about living in them, the works of the flesh. Before Christ, you lived in them. You walked in that fleshly desire. The flesh won. The flesh is what you lived for. And you know anything about a habit? Habits are hard to what? Break. So if you've created yourself a habit, you have lived in sin. That's where you lived before you're saved, right? Yeah, but I got saved when I was real little. You still lived in sin. The sin nature's still there. Understand who you are. I told you the worst thing you can do is lie to yourself. Why? Because eventually you'll start believing it. If I'm going to choose to walk in the Spirit, I've got to recognize who my battle's against, and that's me. I've got to recognize a little bit about myself. I lived in sin. I was in sin. I still have the presence of sin in my life right now. Now one day, praise the Lord, when God comes back, that'll all be gone. And boy, won't that be a good day. But recognize who I was and recognize that I don't owe anything to the flesh. Recognize I don't owe anything to the flesh. Too many times we live like we owe something to the flesh. Like the flesh has one up on us. Like the flesh has the strength to win. Oh, I can't stop doing that. I've heard that said just this past week. I've tried, but I can't stop. It's almost as if you've said, all right, flesh, you win. You're one up on me. I can't do anything about that. Romans chapter 8, verse 12, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. What does the Bible say? I can do all things in my own strength. No. Huh. I can do all things through my, just because I've studied and I've studied and I've studied. I can do all things with my good friends. all goes back to walking in the Spirit. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. See, we're not alone anymore. Stop wimping out against your own sin nature. I can't stop! That's only because you've quit. Because through Christ, all things are possible. Sure, it's still going to be a war. It's still going to be a knockdown, drag-out fight. Yeah! But can I tell you, walking in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I must understand you're going into battle. Understand your battle. I must mortify, crucify the flesh, put off. This is kind of several things here, I know. But this is what I've recognized I've got to do. He says here, mortify. Verse 5 of Colossians chapter 3, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And he starts listing it out. Once again, it means to destroy the strength, vitality, functioning of, to subdue or deaden. I need to make sure that I kill off those things. I remove them from my life. I remove them from being in front of me. The psalmist says, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I have to mortify those things. Deaden those things. Kill those things. Number two, I've got to crucify. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. How did Paul walk in the Spirit? How did Paul determine to walk in the Spirit? He says, I am crucified with Christ. He began to mortify, to kill off, to deaden those things that would keep him from living for God like he ought. I'm crucified with Christ. He says, nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. This is walking in the Spirit. This is crucifying the outward flesh, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Crucifying that, killing it off, mortifying it, so that he could live in the Spirit. Then we also read in Colossians to put off. He talks about being in Christ, and then he says in verse 8, but now ye also put off all these. And he starts listing anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filth, communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds. Put off. Take off. Remove these from your life. Look, you have the ability with Christ dwelling within you to put those things off. No, before you didn't. Before you didn't have the power. Before you didn't have the Holy Spirit dwelling within you. Stop wimping out, Christian. With Christ, you can do all things. So he says to put these things off, to control them. Don't let them control you. He says, you have put off the old man with his deeds. What were those deeds? Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filth, communication out of your mouth. It literally said, lie not one to another. This was just a short list, shortened list of things. Literally, he says, put them off. Don't let these be representative of you. So how can I win my war? How can I win my war? We're talking about walking in the Spirit. We're talking about the battle that it creates, that war going on between the flesh and the spirit. How can I win that war? Let me give you just a couple of points when we be done tonight. First off, put on. If you're going to take something off, now I'm not going to put that one back on because that was my example of the old man, but he says, come over here and put on the new man. Put on those things. He says, and above all these things, Colossians chapter 3, verse 14, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. He gives a list of things to put on. See, with the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. All the opposites of the old man are put on by the Spirit. Now notice, the words put off and the words put on sounds like to me that there's a choice there, doesn't it? In other words, I can allow myself to lose to the flesh. Once again, I say myself, you're not alone. You can give in to the works of the flesh. You can give in to the law. You can give in to all those things. But can I tell you, it's more joyful to stand up with Christ. It says, put on. Secondly, in verse 15, he says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. The peace of God becomes my standard. The peace of God becomes my standard. In other words, I'm going to judge things based on the peace of God in my life. Because I want the peace of God to rule. See, when there's no peace, I know something's wrong. If there's no peace in my heart, something's wrong. And I better do something about it because I want the peace of God back in my heart and life. So that I make that my standard. Having the peace of God in my life. Then he says in verse 16, the word of Christ, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. So I'm putting on the things of the Spirit. I am making the peace of God my standard. Well, how do I do that? By the word of Christ. Listen, tonight you can do nothing apart from the word of God. God doesn't, I don't know of anybody in this room that God has audibly spoken to. Brother Brian, has he talked to you lately? I'm not talking about the pizza you ate last week, all right? But I'm talking about the fact that God speaks to us through His Word. How are you to find the peace of God in your heart and life if you never read it? Can I tell you? Nigh impossible. How can the Word of Christ dwell in me richly if I'm not reading it? Not only reading it, but memorizing it. I've been working diligently on a plan that I've had sitting in my shelf for forever. And it's a simple plan. The hard part is the discipline to do it. Right, Brother Don? The discipline to do it. I think the problem is, Brother Don, it sounds too easy. I got this little book on my shelf, and it's a little, I mean, it's literally that big. It'd fit in my back pocket if I'd remember to carry it. Duh. But it says, it has a little program for memorizing Scripture. It gives you a topic, and then it gives you five verses, four or five, depending on the length of the verses, four or five on a page. And it tells you, if you will read these verses X amount of times in the morning, every day, and I think that night as well, read it through this many times. Don't try to memorize it. That's my problem too. Don't try to memorize it, just read it. Five times in the morning, five times at night. They say at the end of the week, you'll have those verses memorized without looking at it. And you know what? It works. Our brains have this neat little thing going on that if you put it enough in front of it, you'll actually memorize it. Kind of like my girls and the lines to certain movies. Disney movies. They can quote entire movies. We drive to Oklahoma, you know, several times over the last couple of years. And as we drive, we watch a movie. Well, it's an 18 and a half hour drive one way. We watch quite a few movies. And because there's only so many movies we carry, we watch them over and over again. Now I say we, I can quote the movies because I've listened to it for 18 and a half hours one way. I almost want to throw them out, throw them out when we get to Oklahoma and buy new ones so I don't have to hear them on the way home. But you do that with daily things in your lives, you just don't realize it. We've gotten lazy, technology. We've gotten lazy, computers. Where we can call up any verse we want to real quick. Brother Brian and I will be at work and somebody asks us a question. There's a verse about that, isn't there, Brother Brian? Hey, quick, up, get your phone. And we're hunting and surfing, looking for a verse. What happened to thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee? Now, I wonder their sin is so rampant today, right? The word of Christ must dwell in us. And then lastly, as far as how to win my battle, live in His name. Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. In other words, recognizing that you're in Christ. If we would do better if we would just learn that we're not walking with the Spirit, but we're walking in the Spirit. In other words, the Spirit is with us whether we like it or not. So that when you sin, He's with you. You have drug Him through the mud when you sin. When you allow that thought to come in your mind, when you allow that show to come on TV, you're dragging Him through it with you. Tonight, may we choose to walk in the Spirit. Walk. Look, He didn't say run. He didn't say run in the Spirit. Praise the Lord. For all us lazies out there, He just said walk. Walk in the Spirit. Tonight, can I encourage you? Can I challenge you? Look, you choose this. Let me tell you tonight. There is going to be a battle. The battle is going to come from you. But you're not alone. It's going to take discipline to get in, to put on those things that you know are right, to fill your life with those things that are right. It's going to take diligence to get into God's Word. It's going to take diligence to memorize His Word. It's going to take diligence to keep your mindset on the fact that God is with you and you do things in His name. I knew of an evangelist many years ago that would drive between meetings, and when he would get in his car, he'd drive a lot by himself. And when he'd get in his car, he made it a habit of reaching over across the passenger seat, grabbing the seatbelt and buckling it in. That way he was representing in his mind and in his eyes and in his car while he was driving to keep his mind stayed on thee. He was reminding himself that Christ was in the car with him. We do good to remind ourselves Christ, that we want to walk in the Spirit in Him, not with Him. And that means we'll tap into His power. We'll tap into His abilities, not our own. But we've got to decide that. Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit tonight. You know what that means? You've got to get up in the morning and say, Lord, I want to walk in Your Spirit today. Because we've lived too many days walking with or without the Spirit. Even though as Christians we know He's in us and we're not going to lose our salvation, but we've spent too long walking in our mind as if He's not with us, making our own choices, trying to do it in our own strength. And can I tell you, you will lose that war. That's why Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. This morning, would you choose to walk in, or this evening, and tomorrow morning, would you choose to walk in the Spirit with Him? With every head bowed and every eye closed, let's stand to our feet for a time of invitation. I believe God was working on hearts and lives tonight. And I wonder tonight, are you walking in the Spirit? Are you running the rat race of life without Him? Do you know Him as your personal Lord and Savior? Look, I don't take that for granted. There may be somebody here that does not know Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. And I would hate for you to walk out this door tonight, go into eternity without knowing Him as Lord and Savior. Tonight, do you know Him? Christian, have you been walking in your own strength, your own power, your own abilities, and you feel like you're losing the battle? You are. Because you're not walking in the Spirit tonight. Choose tonight. Tell the Lord tonight, I will walk in your Spirit. Tonight on the way home. Tomorrow morning with your help, I'm going to get up and I'm going to pray and I'm going to seek your face and I'm going to walk in your Spirit tomorrow. With every head bowed and every eye closed, would you make that choice tonight as the music begins to play, as Brother Brian begins to sing? Would you come to this altar and say, Lord, I'm coming. I decide tonight I want to walk in your Spirit. Would you come?